Welcome to the studio of NIOS. I'm Dr. Anjali Bajpayee from Banaras Hindu University, and today we are going to talk on significance of heredity in growth and development. Let us first talk what is growth. According to Crow and Crow, growth refers to structural and physical changes in a person. Growth refers to changes in human weight, height, and structure. The disappearance of old features and acquisition of new one is referred to as growth. And development, progressive series of changes that occur in an orderly, predictable pattern as a result of maturation and experience cause development. Development refers to a continuous process of change through which task of managing abilities of an individual are polished, resulting in experience and learning. As we see that growth and development are influenced by our heredity and our environment. Both heredity and environment play a significant role in our development. Heredity is something which is set before birth and is unchangeable. The environment can be modified. So now let us understand what is heredity. Heredity is transmission from parents to offspring of physical and mental characteristics as defined by James Reaver. Ruth Brendit have defined heredity as transmission of traits from parents to offspring. So in other words, we can say heredity is the passing of traits from parents to offsprings. That is, how we look is actually how our parent looked. How our hair is actually how our parents' hair was. How our complexion is actually depends on how our parents' or ancestors' complexion was. Heredity influences growth and development because the child carries genetic endowments from his or her parents. It is genetically transmitted characteristics from one generation to the next, which show in an individual. The physical characteristics like height, weight, eye color, etc., and the psychological characteristics like intelligence, personality, creativity, and so on are innately determined by heredity. The genetic code provides the basis on which brain and body grows and manifest in observable appearance and behavior. So, we can say heredity is passing of certain characters from parents to a child. These characters may be eye color, blood type, etc. Heredity is passed in terms of genes. Genes are a small section of our chromosomes. Chromosomes are thread-like structure which are found within our nucleus, which is the center of our body cells. Human beings, which are known as the Homo sapiens, have 23 pairs of chromosomes. Out of these 23 pairs of chromosomes, 22 pairs are autosomes and one pair is known as sex chromosome. To understand this, you will have to see the human karyotype. As you see, from 1 to 22, the chromosomes are in pairs and having similar structure. Both have two arms and both have a similar looking physical structure. While the 23rd chromosome in females is similar, that is, it is X and X, while in males it is different. It is X and Y. So that is why out of our 46 chromosomes in females, these are of 23 pairs which are similar. In males, 22 pairs are similar and the last pair is made up of XY chromosome. The chromosome consists of genes. These genes are present in allele. Repeat. Chromosomes are made up of genes. These genes are present in pairs called allele. Why in pairs? Because each gene is present in chromosomes and chromosomes have two arms. So, all the genes are present in pairs. Now, how the chromosomes are transferred? Because a human being will always have 46 chromosomes. Out of this, 23 chromosomes, not pairs, 23 chromosomes come from the father, that is the sperm, and 23 chromosomes come from the mother, that is the egg. Now, this process of chromosome division, which divides the chromosome number into half, is known as meiosis. In meiosis, the chromosome number is reduced to half. The sperms may have 23 chromosomes and the egg may have 23 chromosomes. The sperm and ovum contain the genetic information, which is then transferred into the zygote, and the zygote has got 46 chromosomes. The 23 chromosome situation is known as haploid, while human being, the zygote is in the diploid situation, that is 23 pairs or 46 chromosomes. How the sex is determined in a male or a female child depends upon the type of chromosome, sex chromosome, which the sperm contains. If the sperm is containing Y chromosome and it fertilizes the egg, then the child which will be produced is a male having XY chromosome as the 23rd pair. And if the sperm containing X chromosome fertilizes the egg, then the child will be a female having XX sex chromosome as evident in the karyotype. If this number of chromosome changes, like if we have only 45 pair of chromosome, then this individual will be having certain genetic deformity. The 45 number of chromosome in which one X chromosome or one Y chromosome is missing from the sex chromosome is known as Turner syndrome. If the number of chromosome is more, then also the individual will have certain disabilities or certain genetic deformities. In certain cases, when the XXY chromosome occurs in an individual, it is known as Klinefelter's syndrome. This was the case of change in the sex chromosome. Certain cases, the autosome number is also increased. For example, in Down syndrome, the 21st pair of chromosome exists in 3, that is trisomy of 21st chromosome, and that results into Down syndrome, leading to mongolism and defects relating to it. There is another set of disabilities which occur due to sex-linked chromosome, like hemophilia, which is always present in the X chromosome, and therefore when the X chromosome is there alone, that is in the heterozygous condition, then hemophilia is there, that is the male will always be hemophilic while the females will be the carriers. This heterozygous condition I will explain in the coming slides. Can be taken care by prenatal diagnosis, that is by help of ultrasound. Amniocentesis, we can extract a bit of amniotic fluid and see whether the karyotype is normal or not. Or by chorionic villi sampling, in which also we can extract certain cells from the chorionic villi and see whether the karyotype is normal or not. If there is any disorder like trisomy condition or Klinefelter syndrome condition exists, then the parents can be advised whether to give birth to the child or not. And in this way, the hereditary disorders can be averted or avoided in the child. Now, how these transmission of genes occurs is also a very interesting feature, and it was first time given by Gregor Jonan Mendel. Mendel's laws says about three. Mendel laws states that the genetic characters are always present in units, that every character will have an allele for itself. Next is the law of dominance, which shows that only those characters are shown which have the dominant allele. The recessive allele will not be exhibited if that allele is present alone. If that allele is present in pairs, then the recessive character will be exhibited. Otherwise, only the dominant characters are visualized. Next is the law of segregation, that all characters can be segregated in the coming generation. No characters are linked together and can be inherited together. These laws of Mendel helped us to understand the genetic transmission of genes. Besides this, there is also law of variation, that is, it is not always necessary that the children will always be similar to their parent. Law of variation occurs. Variation takes place at a number of steps during the process of fertilization. That is, a part of the chromosome may be duplicated, a part of the chromosome may be deleted, a part of the chromosome may be inverted, and this results in difference in child from his parents. Then there is law of regression, that in successive generation, the characteristics become more towards average of the species from which they are a part of. For example, if one individual is very tall, then his sons and grandsons may not be very tall, they may obtain the average height of the human beings. This is known as law of regression. As we have explained that in case of dominance, law of dominance, only certain characters are visible. Now, those characters which are visible are known as phenotype. Phenotype is the individual's physical and behavioral characteristics, a set of traits that a person actually displays. Now, it may not be genetically same, but the traits which are evident are considered as phenotype, what we see. Genotype is a set of traits that an individual actually inherits, that is his genetic composition. Phenotype are the outward appearance, genotype is the inbuilt genetic composition of an individual. An individual may appear tall, but he may be having gene for tallness and dwarfness both. But because the gene for tallness is dominant, therefore in phenotypic condition, he appears tall. Now, to exhibit traits, certain terms have to be understood. Like just now I said, in the phenotypic condition, a trait may be having a dominant and the recessive gene, but he looks tall, while genotypically he is different from an individual who is having both dominant genes. To understand this, we must understand certain terms like allele. Each of two forms of a gene located on same place in an autosome. As we said, genes are present in pairs and they are located in same places in the arms of the chromosome. And these same places, gene located in the arms of the chromosomes are called allele. Secondly, we said homozygous condition. Certain alleles which are identical and are present at the same place on a pair of chromosomes are known as homozygous. That is, we may have the gene for tallness, that is TT, on the same pair of chromosomes at the same place. Next is the heterozygous condition, having two different alleles at the same place on a chromosome, like we may have a gene of tallness which we might have got from the father and gene of dwarfism that we might have got from the mother. But in this situation, when we have heterozygous condition, only the dominant trait will be exhibited, that is the individual will be tall. Therefore, we say dominant character are which are evident in heterozygous condition also. If we have both genes of tallness, then also a person will be tall. And if we have one gene of tallness and one gene of dwarfism, then also the person will be tall. The recessive characters are which are evident only in the homozygous condition, that is gene of dwarfism will only be exhibited if we have both small t conditions, and then only we will see whether the individual is dwarf. Dominant characters is also rolling of tongue. See, if any of your parent can roll the tongue, then you will be able to roll your tongue. If both parents are not able to roll the tongue like this, then you will not be able to roll the tongue. Therefore, it shows that this is a dominant character which will show even in the homozygous condition and in the heterozygous condition. There are many characters like dimple on the chin, widow's peak, which are exhibited in homozygous condition because they are recessive or dominant. Characteristics of biological influence or genetic influence on human growth and behavior. As we have seen, human behavior are reproduced in successive generations. Behavior in a species are handed over from generation to generation. In other words, a particular behavior continues over several generations. It is generally believed the parents who sing well will have children who will also sing well. The parents who are intelligent will also have children who are intelligent, although variations may occur and law of regression also takes place, that is, the parents may be very intelligent, but the children may not be as intelligent. Another example is taken from animal behavior. For example, goats, because they have inherited that behavior to move in flock, they will always move in flock. The ant follow a straight line because they have inherited that behavior. Change in biological process determines change in behavior also. The change in human growth and behavior are determined by change in biological process. If there is any change in biological structure or process, this leads to change in human growth and behavior. Suppose any part of the chromosome is deleted or duplicated, there will be change in our behavior. Like example of Down syndrome, the child having trisomy in the 21st chromosome are generally retarded, and that depends on the amount of that extra 21st chromosome present. If it is full, then the Down syndrome condition is very severe. If it is in parts, then the condition is very less. But the behavior of the person depends upon his biological structure. As we have said, behaviors run in family and behaviors are transmitted in family. Like we said, if a particular family is having people with good voice, it is most probably then the successive generations will also have good voice. Similarly is the case if certain disorders are present in a particular family, then those disorders are inherited also. It has been observed in families that if a person in a family has mental disorder, others member of the same family may also have same problem to some extent because they carry some similar genes which are transmitted over the generation. Hemophilia is another example. The British royal family, the females were the carrier of hemophilic situation, and therefore Queen Victoria, who was a carrier of hemophilic gene, had sons who had hemophilia, and therefore they suffered from this disease. Genes are evolutionary. Behavior changes occur through evolution of genes. For example, the genes of chimpanzee and human beings are similar, but they are different because humans have evolved. So chimpanzees are closest to human beings and their characteristics and behavior are more or less similar to humans, which can be traced on the basis of history of evolution of genes. Awareness of law of heredity helps us to understand the individual differently. We must utilize these innate abilities for the betterment of the individual and also take care of their innate disabilities by providing proper care and guidance. We must know that the genetic programming of an individual can only be modified to certain extents, and therefore we must take care while we are teaching children various things, because all children have different genetic programming. We cannot expect them to perform in a similar way. Since they are different, we must also give them different treatment. Thank you.